the presence of contaminants of emerging concern in the aquatic environment has become an environmental issue of growing global concern, representing a potential hazard for human health and environment. CSEs comprise more than 700 compounds, which are present in the environment at trace concentrations, meaning micrograms or nanograms per liter. These compounds include a vast variety of anthropic contaminants, both organic and inorganic substances, used for different purposes. Among these, there are, for example, pharmaceuticals and personal care products, endocrine disrupting compounds, industrial chemicals, pesticides, and all their transformation products, which are often still not well characterized. In fact, due to technological innovations, the list of CSEs cannot be exhaustive and needs to be constantly updated. CSEs are often able to produce adverse effects even at these very low concentrations, and for this reason they are also called micropollutants. Among the negative effects, there are both short- and long-term toxicity, endocrine disruption effects, and the development of antibiotic resistance. Most of these compounds are not very much known, and the uncertainty related to their effects is still very large, especially for humans. For these reasons, the European Commission has recently created the priority list, which is a list of 45 compounds for which information and their ecotoxicity is present, so a limit in surface water was set. CSEs constantly enter the water environment through different anthropic sources, including both civil, agrotechnical, and industrial activities. But the most important anthropogenic sources of release of CSEs into surface water are the wastewater treatment plants. In fact, wastewater treatment plants are designed to remove traditional contaminants and not these kind of substances, leading to their release into the environment, affecting natural ecosystems and representing a threat for human health, considering that these compounds might then migrate in drinking water reservoirs. Once released in surface water, CSEs are transported by water either downstream or even within soil, potentially reaching groundwater. CSEs are not just transported by water, but they are affected by several environmental processes. CSEs can accumulate on solid particles and surfaces through a process called sorption, possibly resulting in concentrations much higher than in the surrounding water. This can also occur for living organisms, which often present high CSEs concentrations due to the processes of bioaccumulation and biomagnification. This is also relevant for human health, as CSEs might concentrate in food crops irrigated with water containing these compounds. Luckily, CSEs can also be degraded while present in the environment. In fact, sunlight is able to degrade some of them through a process called photolysis. In addition, microorganisms present in the environment are able to biodegrade some CSE classes, favoring the reduction of the concentration of these compounds. However, both sunlight and microorganisms are not able to completely biodegrade CSEs, but instead produce several transformation products, which in some cases might actually be more toxic than the original compound. Hence, in order to reduce the risk to human health and the environment, appropriate removal treatments should be adopted for the upgrade of wastewater treatment plants, maximizing CSEs removal and complying with future directives and standards on surface water quality. Among the most effective treatments available today for CSEs removal, the most promising are adsorption on activated carbon and advanced oxidation processes, where ozonation is the most widely adopted. Activated carbon is generally used in wastewater treatment plants as powdered activated carbon, having a mean diameter size ranging from 20 to 50 micrometer. The removal is obtained via adsorption, meaning the transfer and the accumulation of CSEs on the porous surface of activated carbon, having in mind that the specific surface ranges around 900 to 1000 square meters per gram, due to the internal porous surface of activated carbon particles. PAC is typically dosed continuously into the wastewater and separated after a certain contact time by sedimentation or filtration without requiring complicated solutions. In some cases, no additional dedicated facilities are required using existing reactors. The adsorption efficiency depends on the two main operating parameters of the process, that are contact time and PAC dose, which optimal values ask for specific lab tests to take into account the presence of effluent organic matter. In fact, effluent organic matter is the main competitor for CSE's adsorption and reduces, even significantly, the chance to remove CSE's saturating active sites or blocking the access to meso and micropores. Powdered activated carbon cannot be reused after being separated, contrary to granular activated carbon, conversely usually adopted in drinking water treatment to remove micropollutants. A thorough technical and economical analysis is hence required to evaluate pros and cons associated to the use of the two forms of activated carbon on a proper time horizon, in view of a long-term sustainability of this polishing treatment step. Regarding ozonation, the removal of CSEs is obtained via oxidative reactions, also promoted by free radicals formation derived from the decay of dissolved ozone under alkaline pH. Rarely, the oxidation is run to the complete mineralization of original compounds. Most commonly, they are transformed into intermediate compounds having a simpler structure. It has to be stressed that the resulting compounds won't be known, together with their potential toxicity. For this reason, the addition of a finishing treatment step by adsorption might be evaluated to reduce the overall risk for the environment, according to a precautionary approach. Ozone is highly unstable and reactive, requiring an on-site production in dedicated generators. Based on the ozone dosage required, pretreated air or pure oxygen can be used. Due to its low solubility in water, ozonation requires closed contactors to enhance ozone solubilization. Here you can see the most common contactors where the water flows countercurrent to the ozonated gas flow, and the water depth is typically around 4 meters to increase the overall ozone transfer efficiency. In addition, when the oxidizable organic load is high, it is advisable to divide the contactor into two compartments. More recently, different configurations have been introduced as pipe contactors or serpentine basins, displaying better hydrodynamics. It is important to evaluate the need of the off-gas treatment in case of the residual ozone concentration exceeds acceptable levels. As for adsorption, the ozonation main operating parameters controlling CSE removal efficiency are contact time and ozone dosage, having in mind ozone consumption inside oxidation reactions of the effluent organic matter. Even in this case, lab and pilot tests are fundamental to evaluate the applicability of the process. Summarizing, it is clear that there is still a large uncertainty related to contaminants of emerging concern, not only for their fate, but also for the assessment of their ecotoxicity. For these reasons, a precautionary principle should be adopted, assessing the risk related to these compounds, supporting the upgrade of wastewater treatment plants with appropriate treatment processes, in order to limit human and ecological risks and increase the preparedness level for the introduction of future water directives.